Hey everyone, this is CJ from Heavyocity, and welcome to episode 2 of The Brief. First off, we just want to say thank you to everyone who tuned into episode 1. Thank you for all the thumbs ups, the subscribes, the comments. We loved interacting with you all after the first episode, and we're so excited to keep the ball rolling into episode 2. If you didn't check out episode 1, The Brief is a video series about storytelling through cinematic music, where we task two composers with scoring the same short piece of footage. And as part of the show, they have to write their cues based on a shared set of guidelines that we call The Brief. All right, let's get right into it. I'm here with two immensely talented composers. Let's start with one of our own. He's a composer, a sound designer, one of our co-founders here at Heavyocity. He's also probably run more miles on foot than I've traveled in my car. Dave Fraser. Dave, welcome to The Brief.
Thanks, CJ. It's I am super excited to be here, especially after the first brief with such an amazing job done by Neil and Ari.
Is there a little added pressure to keep going with the rest of the team to meet the bar here?
I got nervous because I knew like, oh, I'm going to have to like toe the line with them. But I guess, you know, if we start arguing about whose is better, I'm just a tiny bit taller than them. So, you know.
Awesome. Well, we love the competitive fire, and hopefully you can redirect that towards our other composer, our guest composer here for this episode. He's a producer, a songwriter, composer for film, TV, and games. He's giving you the eye right now, Tom Salta. Tom, welcome to The Brief.
Are we on?
We're on.
Hey, Dave, I'm sorry. I thought I was supposed to give an intimidating look.
You did, and you were supposed to, so thank you.
All right,
you.
Good. Awesome. Thank you. Good to be here.
Awesome. It's great to have you. So you've seen a little bit about what we do here in presenting a scene, which I think is a little more like a film or a show maybe presented to a composer for the first time. But for someone like yourself who scored some AAA games from, I mean, PUBG to Wolfenstein to Prince of Persia to Halo, tell us a little bit about what the process is like when you're first introduced to a game as a composer and you're coming in to score it.
You know, it's always so different. I've had the full gamut of experiences. One extreme is I was invited before the game came out to the studio before, you know, in beta to play the game, to talk to the creative team, to give my input and talk about the audio engine and, you know, ground up stuff. The other extreme is I'm just given an Excel document, you know, 6 weeks before the game comes out.
Wow, that is very varied. Wow, that's amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that. We also want to use this show as a way to showcase what's going on with composers that we really admire, like yourself. You have a couple of educational things that you're part of right now. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, even though I'm still scoring full time and working on a whole bunch of games that are coming out later in the year and early next. So right around last year, I released a new masterclass series that will contain lots of educational content. And the first course that is in it is called Game Music Essentials. And I really wanted to send something out to the entire world. So anyone who has any interest in getting into game music scoring, understanding what it's about, even everything from A to Z, including the business side, what to expect in contracts, everything is in one course. It's like a jam-packed 3-hour course. And it's available at tomsalta.com/masterclass. And I'm even going to give you guys a $50 off coupon for all of your viewers here at Heavyocity.
Awesome. That is amazing. I'm sure the community is really appreciative of you offering that. And I'm sure that's going to be really useful. So be sure to check that out at tomsalta.com/masterclass. There will be links in the description as well as the coupon code down below. All right. Well, we are so excited to have you on. And let's get right into The Brief. Okay, so the first element of The Brief here is for story. And for that, we find this astronaut perilously floating through a meteor field. He's narrowly escaped an initial wave, but not without sustaining critical damage to both his ship and his chances for survival. With another wave imminent, the astronaut has made a choice. Rather than chase down his 0.001% chance of making it, he's decided to live these potentially final moments in his best of times, in those moments he spent with her, ignoring the ongoing calculations in his head and resigning himself against the almost certain doom relentlessly racing towards him. The second part of our brief here is for tone. And for tone, the director here wants the score to be in line tonally with the long history of space dramas, films like 2001, Interstellar, Gravity, that have explored this contrast between the vast coldness of space discovery with these kind of warm, intimate human moments. And the final element of our brief here is our director's request, which is really our wild card. And for this footage, the director wants to make sure to infuse intimacy and humanity into this film. And his idea is that he'd like to center the score around what historically are the first elements that humans use to make music: percussion and the human voice. Now, for percussion, it can be any form of percussion, including tuned, like pianos, marimbas, gamelan, things like that. And he's interested in how the composers may use these sources and to treat and affect them. So you're not pigeonholed into just using totally organic versions of these instruments. Okay, so we'll start with you, Tom. You've seen the footage. You've heard the brief. What are your first impressions here? He's gone. He's out.
Do I have to do this?
No, I'm just joking. Yeah, I love it. You know, it certainly reminded me first, I think, of Gravity, because that was, you know, one of the very impactful movie where it really focused on this person alone in the capsule having visions and, you know, emotional stuff. I think it's cool. I mean, I certainly can relate to the human drama of it. There's expanse, and then there's the heartfelt emotion layer, and yeah, I think this will be kind of fun. I think I'll probably grab one of the Heavyocity libraries and just like hold a note down.
Well, we'd love to hear that.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Do you have an approach or an instrumentation type that you like to start with when you're scoring off plan? Is there anything that you go to?
No, I think for me, really, it's about the emotion. I think what I want to do is figure out the emotion that we want to enhance or bring out of that experience. Certainly, if I'm working within parameters of styles, you know, usually the director will indicate perhaps if there's some kind of preference as far as instrumentation, hybrid, orchestral, electronic, organic instruments, whatever it is. So, and the more limitations, the better. I always love the limitations, you know. So give me a box of 4 crayons over a box of 200, and I can start drawing a lot faster and not get caught up in the nuances of which blue I want to use. So.
Yeah, that paradox of choice. No, I totally get that. That makes a ton of sense. All right, let's go to you, Dave. What are your thoughts and first impressions to the scene and to the brief?
At first, when I saw the opening shot, I was completely set to be like, oh, this is going to be a big bombastic score, you know, and then it's like, oh, wait, there is something super, super intimate about what is happening, even in the face of certain what appears to be this guy's demise. So, I think in terms of a score, you know, we're not going to be using damage hits on this thing. I think it's going to be more subtle, so... Well,
oh,
Tom,
man,
you can use them, but, you know, I might throw in a sub boom here or there or something. But yeah, really, really intriguing by this contrast between, like you say, the cold vastness of space that you want to try and get across, you know, completely ironically contrasted by this guy being in this moment, which really is the space. He's reflecting in a moment of like space in his memory versus like this sterile vacuum that he's in this space capsule. So
awesome. Well, I am very excited to hear what you guys come up with. You both sound like you have really good idea starters here. But to recap our brief, for story, we have a space drama. For tone, we have the contrast between intimacy and the vastness of space. And our director's request is to base your score around percussive and vocal elements. Okay, Tom, Dave, you guys have seen the scene. You've got the brief. The next time we see you guys, you'll be telling us about your cue. Let's get right to the work.
Hey everyone, this is Tom Salta, and I'd like to take you through what I came up with for this space scene. So first, let's take a look at the final product. Pretty simple. There's 3 main elements that jump out at me as to what the storyline is and what emotions need to be conveyed. one, that the astronaut's life is about to end. Two, that he's focusing on the things that really matter in life, which is the simple things and love. And three is that there's this impending doom, right? This asteroid or meteor shower, right? So in order to represent those and staying within the parameter guidelines of the director with the sounds, which is going to be mainly percussive sounds and voice. Thank goodness the piano counts as a percussive instrument. So, you know, as far as representing the life coming to an end, right? It's almost like it's a very simple declining, very simple closure. And the simplest thing I came up with was just going down the A minor scale, right? Just the white keys starting on G with a very reverberated, distant, spacey, cool textural piano sound. As far as the love and the simple things, that would be represented by the voice that the director wanted. So I used a solo voice sound for this ascending line to juxtapose against the descending. So the love is getting bigger and the appreciation of the love and the simple things is getting bigger. And perhaps she's moving on to a different dimension, a different life, heaven. So I wanted it to sound angelic. So that line could go up. The piano line would kind of come down, and then the impending doom, which is kind of maybe flashing in the back of his mind, but he's not really trying to focus on. He's trying to tune it out, but it's coming in. It comes in three times, and it gets a little, it happens a little bit closer together as it gets toward the end. So with that one, I wanted to just use this nasty soundscape, also using the percussive instrument. In this case, I used a piano sample. All right, so let's just focus on the sounds used. So for the impending doom, using a piano, it gave me a chance to go through some of the cool sounds in Ascend and find some cool textural stuff that I could just record. You know, like some kind of bed like this. It just makes a noise bed. And the idea that is that I would record that as audio and then just chop it up in those little pieces. I admit that I saw Gravity once, and I think the biggest thing that's jumped out at to me with the sound design is the fact that it kind of used that like on and off thing, and this definitely reminded me of that. So I couldn't resist the temptation, especially the way it was edited. That was clearly edited with that kind of Gravity-esque approach. That's what gave me the idea to kind of have it come in and out like that. Just like it's flashing in, flashing out, hard cuts. So in order to do that, I just recorded these a longer texture, you know, like this. Right? And then I just chopped up, and then I just used a tonal one and then a more noise-based one. Right, just like that, and I just layered them together. Made sure it was in the same key. Right, and then I just put a little reverb on it. There you go. Okay, cool. So next, let's just move on to the other focus, which was the piano line. Again, I was able to use Ascend and put it through just a huge, big... reverb mostly. That was my goal, just to do something like that. Focusing on it. And just try to pace it out. I mean, honestly, it's just an A minor scale. But I started with that. And for the vocals, I used Heavyocity's Vocalize. One was for the solo line. I love that sound, it's awesome. And then you put it through the right verb and... just love it. Just did a simple line with that. And then they had some cool chordal stuff with some vocal scapes. I just was fooling around with some various textures and stuff, which was really, really cool. I went outside of some Heavyocity stuff and just put some extra chords just to help shape the harmony a little bit more specifically, less randomly. That is pretty much it. So when you listen to it all together, of course, there's that little synth hit there. I had to cheat on that one. I just couldn't resist that cold, icy space sound, right? So you got the line on the same note. Now they're going opposite directions. Little textural chord. It's so simple. There's your doom. And there it is. It's the final note. And then over. Done. Simple. Well, there you go. I hope you enjoyed the walkthrough video.
Hey everybody, I finished scoring the scene and I'm super excited to share it with you all. I had a lot of fun working on it, but it was definitely a challenge to balance that sense of high drama and danger with that intimate emotional side of those flashbacks in the middle of the scene. I don't want to say too much, so let's just play through and then we'll talk about it after. Here we go. So, as you could probably tell, I broke it into three distinct sections. So I have some markers set up. I established a tempo of 98 BPM, and then I set up some hit points for the cue. So the three distinct sections are the opening shot, where you have this establishing of space, and then the transition into the space capsule and this intimate moment of his flashbacks and memories. And then that gives way to what I call the transition of doom, where it plays out with the meteors coming and this guy's kind of staring down his fate, and that danger reemerges in terms of the scene. So what I want to focus on is this center flashback section, because that to me was really the emotional anchor of the entire scene. So in terms of the instrumentation, I have all the instrument groups color-coded, and the two that I want to focus on first are the piano and the vocals. These are answering the director's requests. He wanted us to use percussion, and that included tuned percussion, so piano, and then he wanted the human voice. So going into the piano side of things, I used a lot of effectual stuff for the first and the third sections of the piece, but in the center section, I really wanted to create an elegant, emotional kind of heart, you know, pulling the heartstrings kind of a moment. So I came up with a couple of motifs for these two flashbacks. The first one was the F minor, but it's actually F Dorian because there's a major six. So it's kind of nebulous, and then that modulates to C sharp minor and descends to A major, which is kind of almost hopeful, but then immediately goes to the tonic of C sharp and then builds to that really intense ending of the scene. So I want to just play through the piano parts for the scene so you can see how I use the effectual stuff, harmonic overtones, and that you hear there is this twine being pulled through the piano string, and these are all in ascend. And then there's this little glitch vibe sound. And after the second flashback, it goes back to this unnerving, more tense, more dramatic. And these high-pitched metallic whines that you're hearing . These are actually from Evolve, believe it or not. So I thought they'd be really cool to work in the riser kind of vibe for the piece. Okay, so the next in line would be the vocal. So let's solo those. I actually got on the mic and I recorded some vocals myself, but I also used some sampled vocals, if you can see here, Evolve, Mosaic Voices, Vocalese 2. I used the Dynamic Oz for Carla and Sonyi. But my vocals, I did two different effects. I did a glissando F2 to F1, and then I multi-tracked it, and then I pitched it down an octave to double it in terms of octaves. And then I did this kind of a filtery sweep where I opened it up so it felt like a filtered, kind of airy, effectual crescendo. So my vocals alone, this is what it sounds like. And then if we just play the whole thing with the sampled vocals, and I'm going to put the piano in so you can hear what's going on with the piano in the second section and how the vocals play against the piano. Everything gets sucked out. And that sea spray kind of sound is actually automation of the reverb tail that I had on the vocals. So it's pretty effective in terms of, like, it almost sounds like they're at the ocean kind of thing. So the vocals follow the piano and then get into this very unnerving, aleatoric vibe, and bring my filter back and go to black. So really quickly, going through the other elements that also contribute to kind of heightening the more of the first and the third sections, the kind of the transitions, we have percussion and atonal effects. I'm just going to play that down and kind of talk about it as it plays through. So a sub hit from Damage, some cool, very punctuating transitions, and then a little effectual sweep to bring in the dream sequence of the flashbacks. And then the whole back end of the track is building tension and kind of underscoring the meteors. Another sub boom. We have some synthetic risers from Gravity. You can hear some reverses. Again, everything is labeled here. And this is just building that tension. Okay. And then down at the bottom here, pads and effects. If I was a chef in a restaurant, these are going to be like my seasonings that I put on to really take that sonic dish over the top. So these are similar to the percussion and atonal effects in this track in that they add more to the kind of interesting sonic character to different moments in the track. I included the Novo hybrid string pad and a reverse loop on here that I thought were similar in how they added to the track. So let's just play the whole pads and effects. And that's part of the reverb tail that was on the vocals as well. So that tonal sweep is following the piano as well, which is, I really enjoyed kind of doing pitch bending and things like that to really unite different elements in the score. And this aggressive pad that you hear is really adding a visceral quality to the whole, the build on the end. And that I used this Berserker plugin. I think Ari probably, I'm sure he used it on, I think he did. Yeah, he used it on a track, his track on The Brief. So yeah, that kind of runs down the tracks and kind of my approach to trying to anchor it in that emotional center section and bookend it. But I hope you enjoyed it and I'm really looking forward to seeing what Tom does. All right.
All right, everyone, we're back here with Tom and Dave. So though we've seen the work you guys have done, you guys haven't seen each other's scenes yet. So let's get right into it. We'll start with you, Dave. Dave, are you ready to watch Tom's cue for the first time?
I have been waiting for this for, it's like an eternity. Let's get this going. Let's see it. Ah. Oh, I love those ethereal vocals in the background. Oh, that piano on the meteors is awesome. I love it. I love it. Oh, why did it have to end? Oh, dang it. Oh my God, that was amazing.
All right, Dave, so what are your first impressions of Tom's cue?
Oh my gosh. There are some things that I wasn't expecting as it played on because of the way I had treated certain things, like the back end. Mm-hmm. But the fact that the descending piano line and the ascending vocal kept going, it really, like, that just pulled me in so hard. I was like, it was all about that memory and that moment that he was in. Mm-hmm. And it took over the entire back end, which made complete sense. And it was to me, it was a home run. I loved that. And just one other thing, that the piano that came in under the meteors was like a super cool, like subtle, like sinister kind of vibe that the scene needed. So I thought it's super effective. I really liked that as well. So
Yeah, that piano really tied it all together. Awesome. Really, really great. Okay, yeah. Tom, it's your turn. We'll get you all set up and we'll play Dave's cue for you. You ready?
I'm ready.
Beefy. All right. Ooh, attention. Yes. It was so good.
All right, Tom. So let's talk first impressions with you for Dave's cue. What stood out to you listening to it for the first time?
I think really what stood out to me is that after doing mine, I was so caught up in the peaceful, almost just acquiescing and consenting to the end of life kind of vibe that when I heard the building horror and tension, like, oh my God, it was like, whoa, it really got me, you know, stirred up. I was like, wow, okay. Yeah, you could do that too. I guess I was just too scared to do it. It was too uncomfortable to go there and be like, you know, the terror of it, you know, and Dave really, I think robustly, captured a lot of stuff in that very short time. You know, he captured the preciousness of the emotion on the beach and then quickly, seamlessly went into just the horror, the rising tension and horror of the impending doom. So I think that's what I'm so glad that we took different approaches because it really shows you that's a huge choice to make. And neither one is right or wrong. It's just an artistic choice and a different way of perceiving that same thing. It really shows you what music direction can do. No less just music to it in itself can change the entire emotion.
Mm, absolutely. And that's the point of the show, right? To tell us these cinematic stories through the cinematic music. It's really amazing how different these things can be. So back to you, Dave. In your segment, I want to talk a little bit about it because you talked about developing a chord structure for those flashback piano sections. How do you end up making those kind of modal decisions when you're composing, like connecting how you choose what you're doing melodically with the story that you're trying to tell?
Well, it really boils down to obviously the emotion that you're trying to evoke, and certain types of chords, major, minor, are going to elicit those specific emotions. Minor tends to be sad and major tends to be happy, right? But sometimes there's that gray area in between. So injecting different types of tones into the chord, like the major sixth that I put into the minor chord on the first flashback scene, that really gave it, I think I said, a nebulous quality. And then the descending minor to major, I tried to like inject a little bit of a hopeful quality to it, not just for, hey, he might actually survive, but also he's in this moment of tranquility in this flashback. And as Tom had scored it to he's succumbing to the end, I kind of put it like he's in this happy space and he's left already and he's there. But then I turn it around and I go down, you know, I go the brutal way of scariness at the end of the queue. So
yes, you did.
Yes. I hope you don't have bad dreams, Tom. I'm sorry.
Oh, too late.
I certainly will. And then for you, Tom, I noticed in your segment, in your walkthrough, that you really were able to achieve a lot of sound and a lot of story with not a ton of tracks. Is that an approach that you typically take? I know you talked about loving restrictions in the first segment that we talked in. Do you try to restrict yourself to keeping things on the simpler side?
Unsuccessfully, usually. Yes.
I usually do. I'm usually infamous for the guy that puts in too many layers. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you know, you can listen to a lot of my music over the years and you'll see a lot of it's just like, oh my God, there's so many things going on. So anytime I can find a way to just have this, just a broad stroke, simple line that you can just accomplish everything done with the fewest elements, to me, that's a wonderful goal. But even the footage itself and the direction in there, it just pulled me into the idea of a very minimalistic kind of thing. I mean, it's so short and there's so few things going on. You know, it was like, you know, his perspective. All right. So his life, him, then what he's focusing on is the love. That's element number two. And element number three is the terror. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to kind of work with those three, but simultaneously. Like, put them all there. In fact, I was even toying with the idea. I mean, the first thing I thought about doing crazy is score them as complete, like, do the horror score and then do the gentle heart-throbbing score and then, like, switch literally back and forth.
Oh, cool.
Like, which would have been weird. And then I kind of simplified that idea and just went with the short little... So I let it peek through a little bit, but that was the idea. That was kind of like the horrors in the background the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It already started, but we're just like focusing on it just a little bit at a time, just a little bit. But I wanted it to stay in his mind, so that's why it wasn't the feature. It was almost like, yeah, okay, no, don't think about it. You know, just like there, just a little bit. So
awesome. Wow, it was really effective. That's definitely the effect that it had on me, at least, when listening. So, awesome. Well, guys, thank you so much for putting together these cues. Thank you so much, Tom, for being our first guest composer on The Brief.
Honor. And thank you all of you
out there for checking out this episode of The Brief. Please like, please subscribe, please comment below. We love hearing from you all. There are also links to both Tom and Dave's scored scenes in the description below, so be sure to check those out. And we have another incredible guest composer lined up for episode 3, so make sure you keep an eye out for that. Thanks again, everyone. We'll catch you all next time on The Brief.